Good afternoon. Welcome to EduSet Network. Friend, today we have another lecture on understanding research process and practices. In the last lecture, we discussed Indologist approach. Today, we will discuss Marxist approach of research, and in continuous lecture, we will talk about the structural and functional approach. This lecture will give you a proper foundation on which you can base your research and give a direction to the research. Without knowing these things, you can't give a proper direction or the right perspective to your research. So I hope these lectures are beneficial in these perspectives. And for the lecture on this very topic, we have in the studio the same resource person, Dr. Amit Sharma. He teaches sociology in Jawaharlal Nehru University, and research method and theory, he is one of the area of research. So on your behalf, I welcome Dr. Amit Sharma for EduSet lecture on this very topic. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Today we will try to understand the Marxist approach of doing social research, primarily social scientific research. It is very important to understand how the Marxist approach research. Primarily, the Marxists use two methods. One is the historical method, second is the evolutionary method. It is not that both are contrary to each other, rather they are complementary to each other. Now, what is the evolutionary approach? We will try to understand first. From the time of Charles Darwin, the evolutionary approach became very important in the study of phenomena, both biological phenomena and social phenomena. Charles Darwin said that everything has emerged from amoeba, the simplest of organism. And from amoeba to human beings, it is an evolutionary process of development and progress of the biological organism. This approach or this method of evolution became very influential in 18th century social science as well. Those who were influenced by the writings of Charles Darwin in social sciences include names like August Kunt, the founder of sociology, Herbert Spencer, Karl Marx, Emil Durkheim, Max Weber, and Talcott Parsons. They said that as the biological organism has evolved from simple to complex, in the same way, the social facts, the social reality, the social phenomena have also emerged from simple to complex. They said that in the beginning, there was no society. Human beings have emerged from the apes. For example, the gorilla and orangutan, the developed type of monkeys, are our nearest kin. This was the view of Charles Darwin. Therefore, the social scientist claimed that in the beginning, the human beings lived in a natural state, and from natural state they developed their own culture and society. Karl Marx, for example, said that the human development has taken place in different historical epochs or stages. He claimed the first stage as primitive communism, the second stage as ancient society, the third stage as Asiatic mode of production, the fourth stage as the feudal society, the fifth stage as the capitalist society. And he said there is a possibility of a socialist or communist society as well, that is the sixth stage. Karl Marx said that there will be three stages in the socialist stage. The first stage will include dictatorship of proletariat. The second stage will see evolution of private property. The third stage will see the destruction or dispersal of family and marriage. Now, what Karl Marx meant by this? He said that human society undergoes three stages of change. He took these three stages from Hegel, his teacher in philosophy. He said that the first stage of any social phenomena is the stage of thesis. Then there is the stage of antithesis, and finally there is a stage of synthesis. Now, how these three stages of dialectics or dialectical materialism, as Marx said, will operationalize? Karl Marx said that any social formation is made up of mode of production. He said that the mode of production is the foundation on the basis of which different aspects of society and culture develops. He said mode of production is the infrastructure, and all other aspects of society are the superstructure. They include culture, polity, religion, literature, art, etc. Now, what is mode of production? He said there are two aspects of mode of production. The first is forces of production: land, labor, capital, and enterprise. These are forces of production. Land is a natural phenomena, labor is a social phenomena, capital is again a social phenomena, and enterprise is also a social phenomena. Now, some Marxists like Cohen include science and technology also as part of forces of production, but some others include forces of production only emphasize that forces of production does not include science technology. Science and technology is actually the part of superstructure. Therefore, the Marxists are divided into two major groups: those who include science and technology in forces of productions, and those who include science and technology in superstructure. Now, the forces of production determine relations of production. Therefore, forces of production and relations of productions are in dialectical relationship. They are in a dialectical equilibrium, and together the forces of productions and relations of productions determine a particular mode of production, and that mode of production determines the social formation. This social formation is found in all the stages we have discussed earlier, namely primitive communism, ancient society, the Asiatic mode of production, the feudal society, the capitalist society. Now, let us try to understand how Marxist scholars do empirical research. Whenever they face a particular society, for example, the Indian society, the Marxists approach the Indian society like this. They are first concerned with the historical stages. They said that there was a time of primitive communism in Indian society. In primitive communism, there was no notion of private property. The marriage relationship was also not there. It was a stage in which people lived together, but there was no developed notion of family, marriage or kinship. Family, marriage and kinship developed later on. Karl Marx relied on the researches of Louis Henry Morgan, an American social anthropologist, who said that initially there were sexual promiscuity, there was no notion of marriage, then group marriage emerged, then polygamy emerged. Within polygamy, there are two steps, one polyandry and the other polygyny. In polyandry, one man is married to many women, and in polygyny, one woman is married to many men. Polyandry is more popular than polygyny. Then monogamy emerged. Monogamy is the last stage of family and marriage. Frederick Engels, who was a collaborator of Karl Marx, has written a book, Origin of Family, Private Property and State. Karl Marx has not written much on family, marriage and kinship, but the Marxists include the followers and collaborators of Marx as well. Therefore, when Marxists tried to understand and interpret early India, they said that there was a stage of primitive communism. There was no notion of marriage and family. There was no notion of private property. There was no state. Romila Thapar, a Marxist historian of ancient India, and R.S. Sharma, another veteran historian of Marxist India or Marxist approach. R.S. Sharma and Romila Thapar, they have studied ancient India by following the Marxist approach. They were influenced by a person called D.D. Kosambi, who was actually a mathematician. He developed the Marxist approach in history as a hobby. He was a mathematician, but he was, in his private capacity, influenced by the writings of Karl Marx, and he developed methods, Marxist methods and techniques, to study ancient India. Primarily, D.D. Kosambi has written two books which is concerned with the ancient Indian society of Vedic type, Vedic and Puranic type. He has written a book which is very influential. It is named Myth and Reality, and he has tried to understand the sacred books of India, the written literature in Sanskrit, and tried to say that it contains both the myth and reality about ancient India. Now, in his understanding of myth and reality in ancient India, he was influenced by the Indologists like William Jones and Max Muller, primarily the Indologist of the British school of Indology, which we have discussed yesterday. R.S. Sharma and Romila Thapar, they have tried to understand the historical period of India primarily from the time of Gautam the Buddha up to 12th century AD. This is called ancient India. Romila Thapar and R.S. Sharma, they have tried to analyze the Indian society in various books and articles. Romila Thapar had a very interesting book From Lineage to a State, in which she has claimed that in the beginning there was no state in India. There was only lineage. Lineage is a kinship relationship which is found among the blood relations and the marriage relations. Those who are related by blood, they are known as kins, and those who are related by marriage, they are known as affines. Romila Thapar says that from lineage, there was development of a state. The head of the lineage became the head of the tribe. Indian society in the beginning was a tribal society, and later on, from tribe, it became caste, and from caste, it became state. Many historians have disputed Romila Thapar's claim that Indian society lacked the concept of a state, but there are many others who have accepted her claim. R.S. Sharma had primarily studied also the same period which Romila Thapar has studied, but there are some differences between Romila Thapar and R.S. Sharma. Romila Thapar has primarily studied ancient India, primarily the Mauryan Empire. Ashoka and the Decline of Mauryan Empire is her primary work of research in history, Indian history. Whereas R.S. Sharma has given a multifarious facets to Indian history in his many books. One of his very influential books include The Concept of Feudalism in Indian Society and the Decline of Urbanization in India. R.S. Sharma has said that Indian history, ancient Indian history, is a very dynamic history from the very beginning up to 12th century. There was development on the Marxist line, where the mode of production determined the social formation, the religion, the culture, the art, and painting. Another historian, Harbans Mukhiya, has disputed R.S. Sharma. R.S. Sharma claimed that Indian society also had feudal society. Indian society also had feudal aspect, feudal dimension in medieval times, early medieval times. That is, from 6th to 12th century, there was some sort of feudal society in India. Harbans Mukhiya, who was influenced by the Marxist historians, the Marxist historians claim that feudalism was not found in every society in the European sense. Harbans Mukhiya has disputed R.S. Sharma that there was no feudalism in India. He said that there was a particular Asiatic type of relationship between the landlords and the laborers in India, but that lacked the state, which is the defining feature of feudalism in Europe. Now, so far as medieval India is concerned, we have many Marxist historians. Harbans Mukhiya is one we have named. Satish Chandra is the second. Nurul Hasan is the third. And Irfan Habib, Tapan Rai Chaudhary are others. They have tried to analyze medieval Indian history from Marxist perspective, and they have tried to dispute the Indological claim that the medieval India was the Dark Age. Irfan Habib and Tapan Rai Chaudhary have edited Cambridge Economic History of India, Volume 1, in which they have claimed the dynamism and development of society and economy during the medieval period. They have claimed that up to 18th century, there was a very developed industrial enterprise in India. There was also sufficient urbanization in India. And when the British came in India, there was a process of de-urbanization and de-industrialization. Now, this view of Irfan Habib and Tapan Rai Chaudhary is verified by Gandhian economic historian and Gandhian historian Dharampal. He also said that in medieval Indian society, there was sufficient development of science, technology, education, economy, etc. And it is a fact which should be accepted beyond approaches. Therefore, there is some sort of consensus between the Marxists and the Gandhians about the pre-British rule in India. They claim that both the ancient and the medieval society was dynamic and not static, as is claimed by the British historians on the basis of Indological studies. They say that there was enough change, there was enough diversity, there was enough dynamism, there was enough development from ancient to medieval period. And when the modern period came in 18th century, there was different types of changes. Some changes were good, some changes were undesirable and bad. So far as modern historians are concerned, modern Marxist historians are concerned, we can include the name of Sumit Sarkar and Bipin Chandra in particular. But so far as the modern Indian society is concerned, we also have other people than the historians who have contributed to the understanding of Marxist approach. One person is A.R. Desai, who has written Social Background of Indian Nationalism, who has written Rural Sociology in India, who has written about Profile of an Indian Slum and many important articles about Indian society. Then there was D.P. Mukherjee, who has written two books, Diversities and second, An Introduction to Indian Culture. There is some difference between Bipin Chandra on the one hand and A.R. Desai on the other. Bipin Chandra is a Marxist, no doubt about it, but he is also influenced by nationalism of Jawaharlal Nehru in particular and other Congress leaders in general. Therefore, he takes the middle path between A.R. Desai on the one hand and Dharampal on the other. Bipin Chandra is a nationalist historian who shares a view that the British Raj in India was exploitative. Bipin Chandra does not rely only on the Marxist sources, rather he also relies on nationalist historians like Tara Chand and Dada Bhai Noroji or Dutt. Dada Bhai Noroji had written a book which claimed that the British have exploited us and they have not contributed to the development of India. The British rule is not beneficial to India. On the other hand, Karl Marx himself had written two different types of writings about Indian society. One was his thesis, Asiatic Mode of Production, which claimed that the Indian society and the other Asiatic society are part of ancient society in a special way, but they also share the feudal element in it. Therefore, the European society developed, according to Marx, from primitive communism to ancient society and to feudalism, but in Asia, there was development of Asiatic mode of production, which did not match with the European ancient society or the feudal society in toto. This thesis of Karl Marx, the Asiatic mode of production thesis of Karl Marx, is not very popular among the Indian Marxists. But Karl Marx had also written about the British rule in India in his different articles. Some aspects of these writings said that the British rule in India is progressive. This view of Karl Marx is also not very popular among the Indian Marxists. Therefore, we see that Indian historians take some elements from Karl Marx's own writing about India and take some aspects from his method. In other words, the method of Karl Marx to understand society is more popular in India than his own writing on the Indian society. I will give example of two people, one Bipin Chandra, second Ram Vilas Sharma, who has written in Hindi, but his Marxist writings are also very influential and very original. Ram Vilas Sharma has written a book which is called Bharat Mein Angrezi Raj aur Marxvad. In other words, British rule in India and Marxism. It is available in 3 volumes from Raj Kamal Prakashan. This is a very, very important work from Marxist perspective. He has tried to echo the same sentiment and same approach which Bipin Chandra and other Marxist historians have also shared. A.R. Desai, on the other hand, has written 3 important works. One, I said, Social Background of Indian Nationalism, in which he had tried to understand Indian society on the lines of mode of production. He said the British introduced new mode of production in India. It was a capitalist mode of production. It was an industrialist mode of production. And this mode of production disrupted the traditional mode of production in India, which led to 2 different classes, the capitalist class and the labor class. But there was also development of the middle class. The concept of middle class is not very important for Karl Marx, but the concept of middle class is important for A.R. Desai, because A.R. Desai was not only a Marxist, he was also a sociologist. And as a sociologist, he was also influenced by his teacher, G.S. Ghurye, who was himself a student of Sir Patrick Gibbs, who was a town planner, and W.H.R. Rivers, who was a diffusionist. W.H.R. Rivers had a different view about evolution. He did not believe that there was one point or one place from where the human society has developed in all the societies. He said, W.H.R. Rivers said that there have been multiple sources of development. There have been multiple civilizations, and all the civilizations developed on evolutionary basis, but there was also exchange between one society and the other society. It was a free exchange. One society benefited from the other society, and the other society benefited from the first society. This is called diffusion. Diffusion is a notion which says that one idea emerged in one place, and because it was very innovative, because it was very creative, because it was very desirable, it spread to other society during cultural contact. On the other hand, the linear evolutionists like Karl Marx believed that there has been one point, there has been one type of evolution in the human society, from primitive communism to ancient society to feudal society, and from feudal society to capitalist society. This notion is not shared by people like W.H.R. Rivers. And W.H.R. Rivers was the teacher of G.S. Ghurye, who was the teacher of A.R. Desai. Therefore, A.R. Desai is a very creative Marxist, although he is considered an orthodox Marxist, but he was not an orthodox Marxist like Stalin or Mao. He was a very creative Marxist like M.N. Roy. But the other sociologists, for example, D.P. Mukherjee, did not share the view of A.R. Desai. D.P. Mukherjee, who was a student of Lucknow School of Sociology, said that the method of Karl Marx, the dialectical materialism of Karl Marx, is a very influential method, it is a very beneficial method. It should be applied to the understanding of Indian society and its development. But so far as the culture of Indian society is concerned, it had its own salience, it had its own uniqueness, which can be understood only by using the Indological theories, the Indological concepts, the Indological categories, the Indological logic. Therefore, D.P. Mukherjee called himself Marxiologist and not Marxist. A.R. Desai is a Marxist, but D.P. Mukherjee is a Marxiologist. He considers Marxism a science and not an orthodox ideology, and he said that the method of Karl Marx may be applied to different societies in a creative way. Therefore, D.P. Mukherjee synthesized Indology and Marxism in a very creative way, which is very influential in Indian sociology. For example, D.P. Mukherjee influenced the writings of T.N. Madan and Yogendra Singh, who are very important sociologists in India today. On the other hand, A.R. Desai influenced a whole range of Marxist scholars in India. For example, economists like Prabhat Patnaik and his followers have also sympathy for the approach of A.R. Desai. A.R. Desai criticized the urbanization of India during the modern period and said that this urbanization is a capitalist urbanization which is different from traditional urbanization, and it has led to the growth of slums. He has written a book with Pillai on slums, Bombay slums. Therefore, the Marxist approach in Indian society is of three varieties. In one variety, we have people like D.P. Mukherjee and Ram Vilas Sharma and D.D. Kosambi. In the second variety, we have Marxists like A.R. Desai and Prabhat Patnaik. In the third variety, we have Marxists like Bipin Chandra, who shares a view which is both nationalist and Marxist together. Marxists do not believe, as a rule, in nationalism. Rather, they are champions of internationalism. They claim that Marxism is a universal method, but people like Bipin Chandra and his students, they champion the cause of nationalism and Marxism together. For example, some students of Bipin Chandra, like Aditya Mukherjee, have supported liberalization of Indian society from 1991. Although it was a capitalist development which should have been logically opposed or criticized, but Aditya Mukherjee and Bipin Chandra and many others have taken a middle path between the nationalist and the Marxist. Now, some others, for example, G.S. Ghurye, they have also utilized the historical method, but their historical method is evolutionary and diffusionist. For example, G.S. Ghurye has written a book, Cities and Civilization, and he has outlined the role of cities in Indian civilization. He claimed that Indian civilization is a very unique civilization which did not share the features of Greek civilization or the Roman civilization or the Persian civilization, or the Babylonian civilization, or the Chinese civilization, it had its unique features which cannot be understood by the historical typology of tradition and modernity, which was developed by Max Weber in particular. Max Weber was a very influential sociologist in the early part of 20th century when Gourie was a student and a researcher. Max Weber said that there are three types of societies dominated by three types of social action: the traditional action, the rational legal action, and charismatic action. He said that charismatic action may be found in traditional society as well as a modern society, and traditional society and modern society represent two types of societies which can categorized as two types of social formation, two types of society, two types of patterned variables which was developed by Talcott Parsons. Now, G.S. Gourie did not believed in the type of typology which Talcott Parsons or Max Weber were developing. G.S. Gourie said that there has been evolution in Indian society, but this evolution is not unilinear, it is multilinear. It is also sometimes cyclical. Now, the cycle are not evolutionary. Evolutionary method of historical sociology believed that there is one point, for example, this point, and from here there has been a unilinear change from simple to complex in one line. It is a vertical development. It is a vertical development from bottom to top. G.S. Gourie said that there is some element of evolution in Indian society. There has been development from tribe to varna and from varna to caste. But this is not unilinear. There are still tribes in Indian society, and tribes and caste coexist in Indian society. It cannot be explained in unilinear terms of evolution. It can be only defined, it can be only understood, it can be only comprehended from the fusionist perspective of W.H.R. Rivers. Now, there are many others. For example, M.N. Srinivas, a structural functionalist, and Andre Bethe, who followed Max Weber and Karl Marx in different ways in his different studies, who do not share with G.S. Gourie the view that there has been evolution from varna to caste. Romila Thapar had also studied lineage to a state. G.S. Gourie also studied from tribe to varna to caste. But there is difference between the two. G.S. Gourie believed that there was a time when Aryans had not come in India. It consisted of Dravidians, and Aryans came from outside. When the Aryans came, they intermarried with the indigenous people, and as a result, there was hybridization of Varna. Initially, the Varna consisted of three only: Brahmin, Kshatriya, and Vaishyas, and the indigenous people were included as Shudras. M.N. Srinivas and Andre Bethe have disputed this view of G.S. Gourie. Iravati Karve has also disputed this view of G.S. Gourie. They said that Iravati Karve, for example, said that there has been not Varna in the beginning. There has been existence of caste in the beginning. This is the view of Iravati Karve. And from caste, there emerged Varna. She calls it fusion of caste into Varna, whereas Ghurye called fission of Varna into caste. In other words, there are two views. One, that initially, in the beginning, there have been Varna, and from Varna, there emerge different castes. Varnas are only four: Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya, and Sudra, and there are more than 5,000 castes in India. G.S. Ghurye said that 5,000 castes emerge out of four Varna through Varna Sankar marriages. Varna Sankar marriage is marriage of one Varna with the other Varna. Now, this view is not shared by Iravati Karve, who claimed that initially there existed only caste and not Varna, and Varnas are later day development. M.N. Srinivas and Andre Bete share the view that both Iravati Karve and G.S. Ghurye are wrong in their assumption. They claim that caste is an empirical reality, whereas Varna is an ideal type. They claim that Varna never existed in Indian society. There existed caste, and different castes were arranged into the Varna order at the All India level or at the local level, depending upon historical circumstances. In other words, according to M.N. Srinivas and Andre Bete, Ghurye and Iravati Karve, as well as the Marxists like Romila Thapar, are wrong in conceptualizing that there has been an evolution from Varna to caste. They think that caste is an empirical reality, which is a local phenomena. It is not an all India phenomena. According to Srinivas, the same name may be found in different places, but actually caste as an endogamous group is a distinct phenomena. Beyond the district, the caste changes its qualities and structure and function. Now, this view of M.N. Srinivas and Andre Bete is very popular. There are also other critics of G.S. Ghurye, for example, Romila Thapar and Ramila Sharma. They do not agree with the view. Thomas Troutman also doesn't agree with the view that Aryans and Dravidians are two races. G.S. Ghurye shared this notion of Aryan and Dravidian race from Indologists, but the modern scholarship claims that Aryans and Dravidians are not races, rather these are two linguistic families, and there is not sufficient historical proof to claim that Aryans came from outside to India. There is a consensus today that Aryans came to India and they went to Europe among the Indologists. The Indologists claim that the Aryans of Europe or the white race of Europe and the Aryans of India are cousins. And during the British rule, the upper caste of India collaborated with the Britishers because they were convinced with the British view or the European philologist view that the Aryans of India and the Aryans of Europe are distant cousins. They are one people who went to two different geographical directions in ancient time before coming to India. In other words, they share that from the same source, the Aryans migrated to Europe on the one hand and to India on the other, and Rig Veda is the common book of the Europeans and the Indians. This view has been challenged by the Marxists like Ramvila Sharma, Romila Thapar, and anthropologists like Troutman. They claim that the Aryans and Dravidians in India are two linguistic families, and so far as the race is concerned, Aryans and Dravidians are not races. There are different types of race which is found in India. For example, in the northeast, Mongoloid race is found, and in India, North India and South India, another type of race is found which is similar to the Caucasian race of Europeans. But this is a disputed fact, and the Marxists do not give much importance to this. The modern Marxist scholars give more importance to the mode of production, and they claim that economy is the most important thing. This is the foundation, this is the infrastructure, this is the basic structure. And they try to understand the polity, the culture, the literature, the arts, and the science and technology and the foreign policy on the basis of economic causes, economic factors, economic imperatives. In this way, the Marxists have contributed a very important role in evolving a particular type of understanding about Indian society, which is influential in a particular section of academia in India. But there are other approaches of social research in India. For example, the structural approach of Claude Lévi-Strauss, which was made fashionable by Louis Dumont. There was a structural functional approach of Radcliffe Brown, Malinowski, and Talcott Parsons, which was made influential by people like M. N. Srinivas and S. C. Dubey. We will discuss these issues tomorrow. At the moment, we will invite questions and queries.
Okay. You will explain the society composition, its nature, and how it's evolved. So now I come to the practical question of a student when they collect the sources, different sources. So how, for the new beginners, how they will decide that we have to go through these sources, because these are, unless and until we have diversity of sources, we can't reach to a true conclusion. Like if we take up only books written by the Marxists, so only the Marxist facts will come to for the analysis and or for whatever. So for the beginner, how they will make sure that this is written by the Marxist, this is written by this other sort, other kind of authors. So for them, how to help?
This is a very important question. Actually, the ideal situation should have been that a researcher should determine himself or herself which method or which technique will be most useful. But interdisciplinary approach is not very popular in India. This is an unfortunate development, but this is truth. All the researchers in India, unfortunately, are influenced by political ideologies and academic ideologies. And the Marxist, for example, will try to use Marxist theory, Marxist method, Marxist technique, and they will try to gather data from Marxist perspective. On the other hand, those who do not follow Marxism will follow their own method, whether it is Indological method or comparative method or a structural functional method or a structuralist method or cultural analysis method. Therefore, I can only tell you how Marxist researchers will pursue their research. For example, there can be a study of literature from Marxist perspective. Take the novels of Munshi Premchand. Munshi Premchand has written many novels in Hindi. Or take the novels of novels of any other person, for example, Amitabh Ghosh, a contemporary novelist. Now, the Marxist will try to read the story like any other researcher, but they will try to understand what is the foundation of the relationship between different characters found in the novel. And ultimately, they will try to say that the relationship found between different characters in the novel are determined by the political economy of their existence. Karl Marx has a notion that existence precedes consciousness. In other words, one's economic understanding, one's relations of productions, is more important than one's consciousness or understanding, one's love or hate. In other words, it is more important whether you own your own forces of production or not. Are you getting my point? In other words, the Marxists will try to understand first and foremost how the society is economically constituted. What is the foundation of economics or economic relationship? How forces of productions and relations of productions are dialectically related? And on the basis of this, they will frame their question. They will ask their question. For them, the relations of production, whether you own the land, you own the factory, is more important than any other understanding or relationship. On the other hand, the laborers who are wage laborers on the land or in the factory are dependent on their owners. Therefore, okay. Malik Mazdoor relationship.
Sorry, sir, I'd like to interrupt you. We have a question from UMRC Srinagar. Please ask your question. Yeah, please ask your question. Okay, due to technical problem, we are not able to connect him. Okay, continue, sir. Continue with that explanation.
I was trying to say, for example, take another example, cricket. Mm-hmm. Cricket is a very popular game, but a Marxist scholar like Theodore Adorno would like to say that cricket is part of culture industry, cinema is part of culture industry, television serials are part of culture industry, and they are produced the way soap is produced, or carpet is produced, or clothes are produced. In other words, even in sports, even in cultural activities like theater, television, or films, the relations of productions are more important than anything else. This is the Marxist perspective. Whereas the others will take the sports important in itself. They will try to understand the evolution of cricket from ancient, from early modern period to 2000, from 2000 to 2010. In a very, very evolutionary frame, how Don Bradman of Australia used to play cricket, he wanted to play. But now MS Dhoni and Sachin Tendulkar are being determined, they are being dictated by the forces of market. For example, IPL cricket has its own logic, which is not found in Test cricket. Therefore, cricket can be understood from Marxist perspective and non-Marxist perspective in two qualitatively different ways, and both will share almost very simple facts and about other facts, the complex facts, they have diversity of opinion. In other words, different researchers share different ideologies, different approaches, and they come to different conclusions. Sometimes the conclusions are so different that the common reader is baffled by the diversity of conclusions on the basis of the same facts. The same facts is interpreted in two different ways, in three different ways, that the common reader or the audience is confused and baffled. This is not a very fortunate situation. But okay, this is the limitation of modern research.
We take a question from Srinagar. Please ask your question.
Sir, nice presentation you delivered on the understanding of the research practices, but you talked about the mode of production of Karl Marx, and we know that the Marx was a very big critic towards the capitalist economy. But I want to know, sir, you from that, what was his response towards the feudal lords or the feudal system of economy?
His question is, what was Karl Marx's response towards the feudal set of India, feudal lords?
Karl Marx has only two notions. One is Asiatic mode of production, and second is his articles which he wrote in newspapers about the British rule in India. He has not written extensively on the feudalism of Indian society. So far as the feudalism of Indian society is concerned, it is primarily written by R.S. Sharma and Harbans Mukhiya. Therefore, I do not know the view of Karl Marx because it has not been published by any publisher so far. There is one non-capitalist mode of production, which notion, the non-capitalist mode of production includes two different types of economy. One is the feudal economy, second is the Asiatic mode of production, and within Asiatic mode of production, he talks about Indian despotism. Despotism of India, this notion of Indian despotism is not based on primary sources by Karl Marx, rather it relies on the British Indologists and British Orientalists. Therefore, it is a faulty notion which is not appreciated by the contemporary Marxist anywhere in the world.
Okay. So, another question, what researchers should do to minimize the ideological bias?
Comparative method is very necessary. Unless and until there is comparative method, when two methods are compared, we will not be able to minimize the biases.
Do we have another question? Okay. So, comparative method.
Comparative method is very necessary. Mm-hmm. For example, Marxist method may be compared with Indological method of Anand Kentish Kumar Swami or René Guénon, or it can be compared with the structuralism of Louis Dumont, and it will give a very advantageous position to us because it will minimize the bias of Marxist as well as the Indologist or the structuralist.
Okay. So, well, friends, I hope this lecture will help you to understand the different sources, and while collecting or contacting any books, you need to know about the authors and also who has mentioned the statement, what was the influence on him. That will be also good to know before reaching to certain conclusions, what we can say here, because as you cited that Harbans Mukhiya had influence on this.
There are three types of influence on Karl Marx himself.
Okay.
One was the influence of Hegel in Germany.
Yeah.
Second was the influence of Saint-Simon in France. Okay. Mm-hmm. Third was the influence of Judaism, that is the Jewish cultural heritage in which he was born. Mm-hmm. Although he was himself not a religious person, but as a child he was born and brought up in a Jewish family. Mm-hmm. And his concept of socialist society is rooted in the Israeli kibbutz or the Jewish kibbutz concept.
So, better to suggest students to go to the background of the people, what they are making their statements. Just don't take a statement on a face value.
Yeah.
So, that will help him to understand the period and how his thought evolved in this
Certainly.
Way.
Like anybody else, Karl Marx was also himself a product of his own time. And today, some of his views are not very relevant, but so far as his method is concerned, it is still very relevant.
Okay. So,
therefore, analytical Marxism is more important than ideological Marxism.
Okay. So, analytical means, given a time frame, one should analyze the Marx thought and see the other country perspective on that basis. Like he doesn't talk about the religion, Indian religion in fact. So how the Marxist will explain the about religion and culture of India?
Actually, there is a book today,
okay.
Marx and Engels on Religion.
Mm-hmm.
This book is not very popular among the Indian Marxists, but I do feel
mm-hmm.
that this is a very profound book written by Marx.
Mm-hmm.
Marx was not himself religious,
mm-hmm.
but he has analyzed religion in Europe in a very, very systematic way,
mm-hmm.
and it can be useful in understanding Indian religions also.
We have a question from Srinagar, sir. Yeah, please ask your question.
My question is to Dr. Amit Sharma. Our title is Understanding Research Practices and Processes.
Yeah.
It is related to social science.
Yeah.
But as per Marxian thought, there are two methods. First is historical and the another one is, as per your opinion, this is the evolutionary method. How we can use this evolutionary method in the country?
Okay, we have some technical problem. He is asking how this historical methods and evolutionary methods could be applied in the other social science researches. What I understood by the question, because it was not completed, he was midway.
There are two things in historical method. One is called conjectural history. Now, conjectural history has become unfashionable in sociology also. But there is also systematic history. For example, the history written by Erich Hobsbawm is very influential in all social sciences. Any social science, for example, take economics. It takes economic phenomena into account, but economics does not operate in vacuum. Economics has a social setting. It has a social context. Therefore, the Marxist method can be used to analyze the economic phenomena in a historical way. How different phenomena have emerged, how different phenomena have developed. If there is sufficient document, it can be understood how, for example, glass as an economic product has developed as a phenomenon called glass.
Mm-hmm.
For example, in tribal society, you will not have glass of this type. You have different types of glass, for example,
right.
made up of mud
mm-hmm.
or other things.
Okay, I will take another example to understand the way to be studied. Suppose terrorism, if that is to be studied, there are various approaches, Indologist, Marxist, and structural and functional approaches. So how could it be understood differently, terrorism problem?
I think that Marxist approach can be a very useful approach in understanding terrorism, because after all, who becomes a terrorist? Usually a person who is not in his own senses, who is blind in his faith, or who is economically dependent on others. Otherwise, nobody will try to kill himself for a cause which is not his or her own. For example, there are three different types of terrorists. One, the Naxalites, they are also terrorists. One is Jihadi Islam, they also produce terrorists. And there are also non-ideological terrorists. For example, the criminals, they all create terror. From ideological point of view, they are neutral because they may have their own personal justification, but that justification cannot be justified from other perspectives. Are you getting the point?
Yeah.
Therefore, those who try to kill people for their own cause is a modern development. It was not found earlier. For example, there is a concept of jihad in traditional Islam also, but that is very different from the modern jihad. Naxalism has no counterpart in ancient time, but crime existed in all society at all time. And criminal terrorists are found in all the societies, but their operations are different. It can be analyzed from Marxist perspective. It can be also analyzed from Indological perspective. It can be also analyzed from cultural analysis perspective.
Okay. So, well, friends, today we have we conclude the lecture here because of time constraints. So, I thank all of you for watching the lecture, and on your behalf, I also thank Dr. Amit Sharma for giving such an insightful lecture on the Marxist approaches. Tomorrow, we'll discuss about the structure and functional approach. And then we will talk about day after tomorrow the practical aspects of the research, like how to make objective hypothesis and literature review, etc. So I hope you will get a first foundation of all the research approaches, and then we will discuss about the practical ones. So with this word, we conclude the lecture, and I thank all of you for watching the lecture. Thank you very much.